Welcome to the third episode of the Crystal Habit Podcast. I am Megan Marie, the Community Manager at Crystal Dynamics, and your host for this evening. We have a couple of great segments for you, including a guest from the studio who's going to explain the real story behind being in QA. Even though you do play a lot of games, I promise it's not all fun and games. Bad pun intended. You can also expect another Crystal Profile, our regular Take 5 segment with Carl, and details about how to win a custom-branded Tomb Raider Xbox 360. Enjoy the show. All right, everyone, thank you for listening in. We have Chris Bruno, the QA manager here at Crystal Dynamics, and it turns out he's actually the longest running employee here. And we're going to talk a little bit about the real story of QA, because I think a lot of people, having been like a games journalist and having people tell me all the time, oh, you get to play games for a living, I think people have the same perception of QA. So welcome and thank you for joining us, Chris.
Hi, Megan.
So you just mentioned to me, and I'm totally blown away, you are the longest running employee here at Crystal Dynamics?
Yeah, I started in 94, so I've been here about 17 years.
That's a long time. So what are the games you worked on? Pretty much all of them?
Just about all of them, except for maybe the first game we made for the 3DO Crash and Burn, and one aspect of another, I've kind of worked on all the games ever since.
So you definitely got a feel for the job by now, I'd say. Do you have a favorite game that you've worked on?
That's a good question. I love all the Tomb Raider games, of course, but some of my other favorite games besides that. We had a Blood Omen series, Soul Reaver series, and of course my favorite Tomb Raider game would be Anniversary and the one we're working on right now.
Awesome. Okay, so do we want to, well, we'll start with the basics then. How accurate is the statement that as a QA tester, you just get to sit there and play games all day?
There is some truth to that. You are going to play a game all day. You won't get to play multiple games. And most of the time, when we first start out testing a game, you're going to be testing a game that's, hate to say this, but pretty broken. It's going to crash every few minutes, and maybe at the very start, or you're going to have all kinds of graphical bugs or play stopping bugs or things like that. So when you're first starting, yeah, you're playing this amazing game, but at the same time, you're seeing all the problems experiencing within it. So yes, you are going to be playing games if you're a tester, but at the same time, you're also logging all the problems, all the bugs that you're finding. You're going to be regressing bugs. You're going to be working in a database. You're going to be going to meetings, all things like that.
Okay. So is there a difference in, just for clarification, is there a difference between QA and the term play tester?
Sure. Like QA is quality assurance. So normally if I hire you as QA, you're going to be working on the game 40 plus hours a week, sometimes, you know, in certain situations, 60 plus hours a week. And you're going to be testing the same game over and over again, day in, day out, 5-7 days a week for months at a time, up to like a year probably. If you're a play tester, that means we invite you in for a couple hours, maybe even day session, just to sit down and play certain levels that we want you to focus on and give us feedback. So that's pretty much the difference.
So how does one become a play tester then? Where do you find your audience when you're looking for kind of those testers just to come in, give some outside feedback, and then?
We're always looking for play testers. Normally we try to find people locally. Sometimes it's through, you know, different online places. We try to find people that play the kinds of games we're making, and also people that don't play the games that, you know, we are making as well, just so we can try and find new audiences.
Okay. So you said for the QA testers, the people that are brought on and they're hired, how long is it, like a staff that is continuous, or do you bring in people for certain projects?
It all depends on how many games we have going on at the studio at one time. So sometimes we'll have a core team of, let's say, 3 to 5 people that are like full-time employees here. But other times, if we have breaks in between, we'll only have contract employees that could be like 4-3 months to 6 months to, you know, 9 months.
I'd love for a breakdown of actually what a day is like for one of the QA people that you work with. In terms of, you used a bunch of terms. Did you say regressing?
Also? Regressing bugs, yeah. I can kind of break it down for you. So you come in the morning, you get your daily assignments. It might be anything between, hello, you come in, you're going to be doing, let's say, collision testing all day, which means you're trying to find holes out of level, or you're going to do sound testing. We'll put you in like the sound room, and you'll be doing sound testing, making sure all the sound effects are working correctly. Or maybe you'll just be doing a fast playthrough or a full playthrough of the game. So we have like a test plan that we put together that kind of takes all the aspects of the game, breaks it down, and then we assign it out to the different testers. So you come in, you get your build, and then you will probably regress any claimed fixed bugs, which means like if you wrote bugs, you know, day before, week before, the team members will actually mark them claim fixed. And then it's your job on the next build to check them to make sure that they're actually fixed. Once you've checked all your, you know, bugs that you need to for the day, then you take your assignment and do that. And you'll be logging into a database and you'll be finding new bugs and adding them in. And we have a specific way that we have bugs written so that they're all uniform so that anyone can read them and understand exactly what you're saying. Mm-hmm. And then we try to keep you for overtime as much as we can. No, I'm just kidding.
How much training goes into that? Is there a lot of work that needs to be done to ensure that all the QA testers are logging things the same way and making sure everybody's speaking the same way so that it's easily fixed?
Sure. A lot of times we'll bring back people, or because we're in the Bay Area, there's a lot of people that have tested in the industry quite a bit. So sometimes I'll bring people back so they have more experience on it. But even if I hire somebody that's brand new, I'll sit down with them and I'll actually train them for about a week. We have like guides that we'll present to them, and we'll have them, you know, learn about the game first, and then we'll have them start writing bugs. Then we'll kind of like give them time to learn. But yeah, I actually train all the testers that work here.
So when they're looking at a segment of the game, or, you know, like the audio or of a specific area, are they mostly looking then for bugs, for errors, for glitches, or are they actually looking for are you actually looking for some creative feedback also? Feedback is how they perceive something or what they think about a certain segment.
Sometimes we'll do that. We'll have like developers come to us and say, hey, I just put this new weapon in. Can you test it out? Let me know how it works against these enemies. So we can give feedback in that ways. Also, if we're playing through the game and we find places that are too hard or too easy or things that we can think that would make a better game, then we can add suggestions to our database. We have different categories of bugs. We have A bugs, which are like main stopper bugs that make the game crash. You can't play through the game anymore. There's B bugs that are like affect gameplay in some way. And then C bugs are more graphical or things that don't quite affect gameplay. But at the same time, we like to get them fixed to make the game a better overall experience.
And how soon do those usually get turned around? You log them, and then do you have a new build the next day, or is it something that happens later next week?
We get daily builds here at Crystal Dynamics. So every day a new build's compiled. We compile new builds daily, and it all depends on the workload and the development process. So like if you're early in development, you know, bugs might sit for a little bit longer because they're still designing particular areas or levels. But as we get closer to our submission dates, like bugs that come in that are high priority, those get fixed, you know, daily by the development team.
And what are the most common source of bugs that you do find on a daily basis? Are collision bugs pretty common?
They are for a while. I mean, once we do a few collision passes, unless like the actual level changes in some way, it gets pretty locked down. Mm-hmm. Or if, like, let's say the character's jump gets changed from, like, you know, a certain amount of meters or feet to a little bit higher, then some places we'll be able to get out of level in different ways.
Okay. You mentioned to me prior to the podcast that at some point in time you used to coordinate some of these user research specific playtest sessions where you'll bring someone in. We also just recently talked about that. But how are those differing from traditional playtesting sessions, or, well, traditional QA sessions, now that I know the difference? When you bring in these playtesters, what specifically are you looking for?
Normally we'll have like one level or four levels that are kind of newer levels that we want feedback on because they're like in the development process. So we have people sit down, and sometimes we'll have like three different people a day sit down for like 2 or 3 hours, and they'll come in and they'll play through, you know, these levels that are still in kind of development process. So there's things that aren't quite finished. And we kind of judge their reaction on them, like, hey, did that person see that sign or that jump, or did that enemy move in the right way that they wanted? So what we're doing is we're looking for fresh eyes on the game so that they can tell us more or less like how to make a better game before it's actually locked down and finalized.
Does this sort of testing go on more in the earlier stages than it does the latter, or is it continuous?
For the last many years, actually, it kind of goes on throughout the whole thing. Mm-hmm. I mean, in the first stages, when the game's early, you definitely have a bigger chance to make a bigger effect. But once it gets closer to the submission process, then it's more of like little things like, hey, can we tune this thing just gently to make it a better experience at the end?
And are the bulk of these people ones that are very trained in specific types of games? They understand mechanics? Or do you also look for, you know, are you looking for someone who understands action-adventure and all that? Are you looking for someone who specifically, you know, doesn't know anything so that you can get a fresh take on it? Or
it all depends on what game it is we're doing playtesting. Like our current game, it's I guess we're trying to find people that are more into a particular genre, whereas our last game, the Lara Croft and Guardian of Light, that was more of a kind of broader audience, I think, because it was like a pick up and play kind of a downloadable game. So we kind of wanted to have all broad spectrums of people coming and playing it because we thought we'd be able to get like a bigger audience. We wanted to appeal to more people.
Okay.
If that makes sense.
It does, definitely. So I'd love to understand from the very early stages to right up to launch, since you've launched so many games here, how is what you're searching for changing? Do you, what point in time do you start getting really nitpicky? And at what point in time do you, I mean, are you ever done? Are you ever done QA testing? Are you, until you ship and it's gold?
I mean, even like right up till submission, we still might find things. Towards the end of the process, I mean, I guess I could start at the beginning. I mean, there's a couple phases of the process. There's like a pre-alpha stage, which is before the game is actually put together and it's kind of mostly finalized to where all the levels are complete and ready to go. And then once you get to the alpha stage, everything should be in and pretty much locked down. We can still change things if we need to. Then you get to a beta stage where everything is definitely locked down. Everything after beta is only bug fixing. And then you do that for a period of time until submission. At that point, like, everything needs to be done and completed. As people might have noticed in some Tomb Raider games, you might find small like glitches here and there. And it's one of those things to where it's like, we've probably found that bug, but it's whether or not we need to get the game out on time to whether we can actually get that fixed, or is it going to be, it's kind of like a give and take. Like, if we fix this one thing, is it going to cause a bigger problem within the game?
Is that something that happens? Can you, do you often get like a cause and effect where you fix something, then something else will?
Oh, sure. Like when, let's say it's a small little graphical bug, somebody will change the particular graphical problem, and then in the next build, there might be a whole hole in the mesh instead, and you'll fall through it and you won't be able to get through that level. So it all depends on how safe the developers are on actually doing the fixes in the game.
Yeah, I can imagine. So I know we've already shown some, obviously, footage to the public and to the press. We have the scavenger den area, and we've showed a little bit of the Night Hover the Village area behind closed doors. How long did it take to get those builds ready? Because that was a huge opportunity. The first time we're showing it to the world is like on this giant Microsoft stage. So how long and how hard was the team working prior to showing off the game for the first time to make sure it was ready and that everything looked great for the stage?
That's a great question. We had about three QA people working probably a few months on it. And then for the last push, we brought in an additional, I think it was five people, just to make sure everything was perfect. And we had them testing like 10 hours a day, just finding every little problem that we could possibly, you know, find, just to make sure that that stage presence went off without a hitch. I think it turned out pretty good overall.
Yeah, I think it did.
We were
too.
All watching it going like, all right, let's make sure this is perfect. And it seemed to go pretty smooth.
Is that like so nerve-wracking when you're sitting there watching it live?
I think it was pretty good, like when it was ready to go. I actually, what was it? Before E3, before we sent the stuff down to E3, I came in at like, what was it, like 4 a.m. just to do the mastering for, because I do other jobs here too, but I did the mastering, got all the builds ready, and we sent them down to E3. So it was like, we were pretty sure there wasn't going to be a problem, but at the same time, like, you're watching, it's like, what if we miss something? What if it crashes? Because I think there was one of the game at E3 that was maybe it was an Xbox demo where it did crash, or there was a controller missing thing.
Okay, I think that was at Modern Warfare 3 where his controller disconnected. You know, people have a sense of humor about that stuff.
Totally.
You can't always, not everything can go perfect, but you can work your hardest to make sure it goes.
But if we have 6 minutes and it goes flawlessly, you know, that's a lot better, I think.
Great. Well, a lot of the people, obviously talking about the Microsoft presentation, they've seen that demo. Most of the people listening have, since they're big Tomb Raider fans. Do you have any...
Do I know how many times we played through that
before? Yes, I'd love
to. I'd say thousands of times we played through that six-minute sequence just to make sure. You know, I mean, thousands of times between all the testers and also the dev team that was playing through it at the same time just to make sure it would work properly.
So obviously, like, Daryl and Dan had like a very specific path and idea that they were going to walk, you know, they knew what they were going to present. But when you guys were going through it, do you intentionally veer from the path and like account for certain things? Do you look or interact with objects that people may not? Like, how into the nitty gritty do you go?
When it's something like that, I mean, we find out what their path is. They come over and they demo, they say, we're going to do this exactly. So we put certain people on that, like that's their job all day. Play through that 6 minute demo on that path over and over and over again. And then we have other people that are just try everything else just in case something happens, they move off the path. So we
And so what are some of those weird things that you have them try? I mean, do you just literally have them like trying to climb every object, trying to jump?
That would be collision testing, jumping on everything. We put somebody in like a sound room and go to every corner, make sure every voice plays perfectly. We have people move forward and then move backwards to make sure like everything works properly. All kinds of other different kinds of tests.
From a graphical standpoint, how do you approach a room? Do you just look at it and you have them try to look at every object and look at every detail? And
well, there's like camera issues that you'll find where, let's say, a camera goes into a wall or this object blocks your camera or things like that. There's so many different kinds of bugs. I mean, when we're logging bugs in the database, there's probably about 30 different categories of different kinds of bugs, whether it's AI problems or, like I said, sound problems or special effects problems or graphical problems. It's just, there's so many things that you can find
in a game.
There's
so many moving parts.
Yeah. I think one of the problems now is when I play games on my own time, which is less and less after 17 years in the industry, but it's still a lot of fun to check out other games, but I'm constantly looking for bugs in other people's games because that's just how I play games
now. I can imagine that's very hard to turn off.
And I'll find them too.
I found that too, going from working in games press, like it's very hard to look at a game sometimes and not, and turn off the critical part and just turn on the fun part. And it's a little hard, and I can imagine it'd be a lot more difficult for QA.
Yeah, I'll give you an idea about this. I mean, testers can be a pretty crazy bunch. You put people like in close situations for 8 to 12 hours a day playing the same game. They sometimes can go a little crazy. Some people crack, and sometimes they'll just quit. They're like, I can't do this anymore. But if you imagine your favorite game, and you imagine it's really broken, playing day after day over and over again, now imagine it's just like one level of the game. And now imagine it's a game that you have learned to dislike over time, even though it's the greatest game in the world. Being a tester just takes a lot of determination and attention to detail.
So when the game ships, are you going to play it?
I'll probably play it for Microsoft points for sure. I'll definitely watch my friends and my family play through it for sure. But yeah, it's one of those things to where I've seen it, I've done it.
I've seen it all. Well, I know I just want to focus a little bit more on you really quickly before we're done with this segment. You do more than QA here, correct? You have a very encompassing job. So what are some of the other tasks here that you do for Crystal?
Great question. I do a couple other different things. I'm in charge of all the mastering in the company. I'm in charge of like getting builds fingerprinted, file transfers, worldwide, you know, distribution of files. Creating like demos or press builds. Fingerprinting is like we put an image onto the disk itself so it can't get out to the public. Other things I do, I'm the asset librarian. I'm in charge of like all the Crystal assets, our library of games. We have like playthrough recordings of a lot of competitor games, books, videos, etc. I'm the database admin, so I'm in charge of creating new databases for all our games, maintaining current databases, getting new users in there and modifying the database to fit developer needs. I also do proofreading of manuals. I do proofreading of like strategy guides.
Well, I suppose that's the best person to have look at those strategy guides and those manuals and stuff because you do know the game in and out. At that point in time, I would assume you do. Well, it does seem like you're definitely a jack of all trades.
I've been here long enough to where if people have questions about things of old stuff, you know, I probably definitely have an answer somewhere.
Well, I'm going to take advantage of that in the future now. Okay. Now that I know that you're this infinite wealth of knowledge.
Sometimes. If not, I'll probably know how to find the answer.
All right. Well, thank you so much for your time and for stopping in.
Thanks for having me.
We will be back with another Crystal Profile in just a second. All right, we are back with another Crystal Profile, which is basically a quick look at someone who works in the studio. And today we're featuring one of my fellow brand co-workers, whose name is Estuardo, we call him E-Dub, Sandoval. Sandoval, did I say it right?
Sandoval.
I practiced close enough, though. Yeah, I practiced before the podcast, and I still managed to mess it up. I like just calling people by their first names or nicknames. So yeah,
people always have trouble with that one anyways.
Yes, so E-Dub, we'll go with that.
That works.
He's the creative brand manager here, so you do a lot of stuff. But first, we'll talk about how long you worked in the industry and what you did prior to joining Crystal Dynamics.
I've been pretty much at Crystal the whole time in the industry here, about 7 years now. Prior to that, I was, you know, fresh straight out of school. Kind of got my big break at our school portfolio show where I met my feature supervisor and kind of went from there. Started off doing cinematic stuff, helping out as an assistant on cinematics, and then from there I just quietly moved up. So I am now.
Who was the supervisor?
His name was David Goodwine. He was pretty much the director of creative services. And like I said, he came down, saw my work at the portfolio show, and kind of went from there.
Cool. We'll have to come back to the portfolio show thing, because that sounds like it's probably pretty important to getting yourself out there in the industry. So you worked here pretty much the entire duration, 7 years. What do you do? You seem like a jack of all trades. Like, creative is a big, broad
I do quite a variety of things here. I've been doing quite a variety of things for the past 7 years now. But that means anything from graphic print stuff to web graphics, assets, trailers, anything, video, internal videos, external videos, just a whole wide range of.
So what specifically did you go to school that taught you to do video, taught you to do print, taught you to do logo design, and even cinematics?
Well, I went to school for media arts and animation, or the main focus was, you know, animation and like motion graphics, stuff like that. And then along that, you kind of learn the basics of, you know, video and graphics and stuff like that. And then on my own, I pretty much took the graphics and the video side of it on my own and kind of built it up. Because after the introductory stuff in school, they really focus you more on the motion graphics and animation stuff.
But so you found areas that you wanted to expand upon and then just use your...
Yeah, definitely. And I think once I got into Crystal, I was able to expand on those areas as well, as far as doing a lot of different graphic stuff and a lot of different video stuff.
So let's talk to fans kind of about some of the projects you've actually worked on. So in the last year, what are some of the big things that you've been working on that that they would see your work in? The making of the trailer, I know, was a huge one. You were engulfed with that.
Yeah, the making of the trailer. There was a lot of behind the scenes of the actual trailer stuff. But basically, the making of covers of the Game Informer stuff, making of trailers.
And those you didn't just put together the video footage. You actually recorded all of the video footage.
Yeah, we did all that from scratch, and then kind of created a script from the get go, and then kind of built it up from there. Created assets that were needed to put those videos together.
You recorded it against a green screen, and then popped in all of the cool visual effects and like the freeze framing for the titles and the desaturation and all.
Yeah,
that.
Yeah, we kind of just built it all up from the ground up, and then used some footage from Japan, used some footage we filmed here. Like you said, a lot of green screen stuff.
Splice stuff together.
Yeah, and then I guess just putting together a timeline that kind of flowed together well.
Which is something that I'm always impressed with people that do video, because it's very hard to think. You have to think, you have all this raw footage and capturing that and thinking of it in terms of a timeline and what cut would work best and all that. It's very impressive when they come together. So, like, what other sorts of projects? I know you helped me out a lot with the official badges for the Tomb Raider fan sites, which turned out great. Other visual things you've been working on?
There's been a couple other things for Tomb Raider. There's been a few things for these other projects we have currently in the works internally. As far as visual and video stuff, I guess just the making of stuff is really still at its early stages as far as the creative stuff for brand goes for Tomb Raider. But as Tomb Raider gets further along the timeline, I'll be doing a lot more assets for that as far as trailers or internal, external videos, making of, behind the scenes, documentary stuff, just really documenting the work that goes around here in the studio and creating assets, like I said, for help marketing and help push the game.
So do you have a day to day? Is there like, are 2 days ever similar, or is
not
like...
really. It's every day is different, you know. Like I said, one person from one project might come to me one day and say, hey, we need this for, you know, to help pitch something or to help lock down a certain visual style for something. Or another person from a different project can come and, you know, request something. So it's always, like, ongoing. There's always something different.
It's more project-focused than day-to-day.
Yeah, than day-to-day. There's not really, like, a, you know, a set schedule that I go by, you know, Tuesday, do this, Wednesday, do that, Thursday. It's always just come as it comes, you know.
Okay. So any advice for someone that's hoping to get in the industry through your field? It sounds like those sort of portfolio shows should be taken pretty seriously because you can get your break at them.
Yeah. For something like being on the creative side of, you know, whether it's on the game or brand or marketing or whatever, I guess the good thing would be just to build your portfolio all around, just kind of like tackle a little bit of everything and then try to find your niche from there or, you know, concentrate on all areas and just, you know, expand your skills in each area.
So do you think in your portfolio, is it more important to develop your own personal style and voice, or is it important to kind of show that you have a lot of variety, not necessarily in like the technical skills, but the sort of like art direction that you pursue in your pieces?
Yeah. As far as my portfolio went, it was very stylized to my
your particular style.
My particular style. It's something that a lot of game professionals in the industry want to see is this young talent coming into the studios. They want a fresh new look, fresh new perspective at what's going on. So it always helps to have an individual style, individual look to your piece. Of course, you're always going to want to have those technical aspects for portfolio and show that you can do, you know, A or B. But the very important part is to just come with some fresh new ideas for the industry. Really, like I said, young people help create, you know, awesome new games and new ideas. They bring them to the table. So
great. Well, that should definitely be helpful to some of the people looking to get in the industry. Like I talk to a lot of people online who are constantly looking for advice to get into different facets. So that's why these crystal profiles are helpful. Well, thank you for joining me.
Thank you.
Carl is now joining me for our Take 5 segment. As we established last time, it's his favorite segment of the podcast, correct?
Hello. Yes, it is. It's all my right. Favorite.
Let's jump right into it then. Question one, will we see Tomb Raider on the Wii U or any Nintendo platform? If not, why?
At this time, no. And to be honest with you, I don't think we'll see it come out on Wii U. Because when we started developing the game, we made the conscious decision to say that it was all about building the game for the platform, making sure the experience was unique to that platform. And given that we've been working on the game for quite some time before Wii U was announced, I think it would not be right to try and port it across and just make it work for the Wii U. You know, I think if we start building a game for the Wii U, we'd build it very differently, and we'd build it with different functionality, but no, there's no plans right now to port it across. And I think that's one of the big problems that we've had in the past is that people have sort of seen that one experience on the 360 and then PlayStation 3, and then they see that we bring it to the Wii, we bring it to the DS, the PSP. It's just the same experience, and we want to get away from doing that. If we create anything for any other platform, it'll be unique to that platform.
Good answer. All right. Question two, are there any other plans to remake other Tomb Raider titles like we did for Tomb Raider Anniversary, such as Tomb Raider 2? That's the most popular request I get. Everyone wants to see Tomb Raider 2 redone.
No, there's no plans right now or in the future to develop any other Tomb Raider title apart from the one that we're currently working on.
People can play them on the PlayStation Classic.
Yeah, you can still play them on PlayStation 3, and you can download them from PSN Store. And I think the European one just went live on Tomb Raider 2.
We put a press release out. I did. So now people were waiting patiently for like a year, I think, for that one to port over in Europe. So
yeah, I think it was, I can't remember the reason for it being so late. I think it was because we couldn't, I just don't think we could find the original master disc for Tomb Raider 2 for Europe, for, was it PAL for Europe? I keep forgetting which is, because I'm European, obviously. For me, it's like every time I say PAL or NTSC, I get it wrong. But for Europe, I think we couldn't find the master disc. And then we ended up having to take the American one and port it across and try and get it to work. So apologies for taking as long as it did. But the guys have been working hard on trying to make sure that we bring it out. Because it's been out in the US for quite a while now.
Better late than never.
PSN. Yes, better late than never. But to answer your question again, no, we have no plans whatsoever right now to develop any other previous Tomb Raider title. As you know, our goal is to start from day one. This is it. This is Lara's new adventure.
Question three kind of goes in line with the Lara's mansion and all those kind of questions, but I'm still getting them. People are still asking me, so we're going to clarify this one more time. Will the doppelganger or Curtis Trent make appearances in the new Tomb Raider?
No and no.
I like definitive answers.
I could sit here and try and elaborate and give you some lengthy reasoning, but to be honest with you, right now there's neither of those characters play a part in the future of well, certainly in this version of Tomb Raider.
All right, thank you.
And can I just say to everybody, Megan made me sit so far away from her this time. I'm like at the other end of the entire table.
I know, it's like at a, you see like these huge dinner tables and giant dining rooms.
I walked in, she was like, get down the end of that table. You're not sitting beside me today.
Yeah, well, that's what happens when you don't know how to, you know, troubleshoot audio. You have to just make someone sit really far away from you so there's no reverb.
Okay.
We're learning as we go, folks. Question number four. Are the controls nearly done by now? PC users would like to know if they will be forced to use controllers on the PC or if it will have the proper keyboard and mouse setup. And we actually do have a lot of people inquiring about PC.
I do as well. I get a lot of tweets. I get a lot of people asking me that question directly as well. I used to be a big PC fan, and I appreciate that people like to play with mouse and keyboard. And we've already kind of started talking about the PC sort of keyboard layout. So, yes, my goal would be that when we launch, I think the team's goal working on the PC SKU would be to have both the controller that can be plugged straight in as well as keyboard and mouse. So we'll keep you updated as we go through, but I think you know, PC users who are hardcore need to have a keyboard and mouse. It's in their DNA.
Yep.
Picking up a 360 controller is just not the same. So watch this space. We'll be working hard on that and hoping to make it happen.
Great. And the last question. This is one I actually, it's kind of an all-encompassing. Many people notice that we're hiring, and we are.
We are.
They are constantly inquiring what the best way is to secure a job at Crystal Dynamics. And one particular person asked, is experience needed? Can you be fresh out of school? Does a portfolio speak volumes, or do you need that experience? So any just tips or advice you could give to the people who are looking at applying for any of these positions at Crystal?
Have confidence and be awesome.
Being awesome is always
being
good.
Awesome is always good. We like people who are awesome. We take people into the studio from all different levels. We take them in, you know, straight out of college. People have come in on contract and we've kept them. We've gone sourcing people to try and find the right people for the right thing. It all depends on the requirements. I know when you take something like combat, combat's very important for us. So we needed experienced people. So the team that we have working on combat, we've basically gone around the industry and looked at many, many games and many people and interviewed a lot of people. And we've actually cherry-picked the people that we've wanted. But in terms of that, we have artists. We have Brennock, who has worked on maybe one other game. I think I need to check with him. But I think one other game, and it wasn't really big participation, but he wasn't that long out of college, and that guy's a rock star.
Mm-hmm.
And I think if you're really, really talented in whatever field you're applying for, that will shine through, and there's no restriction. We wouldn't not be hiring somebody just because they're fresh out of college. If you're good, you're good. We'll be able to see it in you.
Another question for, I know a lot of younger people
this
inquire
is
that they haven't.
Six.
I know it kind of it piggybacks off. I want answers to this because I genuinely want people who really want to work in the industry to.
Megan sits right outside my office. And she never asked me this many questions. I'm only kidding.
This is my chance, right?
Yeah.
So, for people that are younger and haven't necessarily picked a specific field that they want to specialize in, and you know they know they want to work at Crystal Dynamics, they know they want to work at a studio. What do you recommend? I mean, is speciality the way to go in terms of like know exactly what you want to do or what you want to work on in the game dev side?
I think if you have the benefit of going into college now and picking a field and you want to work in video games, then start working on that. But like, I'm a classically trained animator. How I got into this position, I have no idea.
There is some organic element to it.
Yeah. People, you know, when I finished college, I didn't know what I wanted to do. I, you know, had this great opportunity to work in animation. I moved into marketing and then moved into brand. And now I blend the two of them together. And, you know, I've become a particular type of person when I work because I understand two fields. So I wouldn't say just because you didn't study it in college doesn't mean you're ever going to get the opportunity to do it. There's many people outside in the studio who, if you ask them what they did, I guarantee you one or two of them probably worked in finance to begin with. I probably have some politics degree. You know, if you're in college right now and you have the opportunity to study something that you're really passionate about, go and do it. If it's video games, then continue. And, you know, you may have an upper hand, but when you finish college, you probably will because you've been studying that field. But it's not critical that you have to have studied it to get to work in the field. If you've got experience and you've got passion and you want to change, hey, if you're good, anybody will take you. Yeah, networking is a big thing. Make sure you network. Make sure you get out and talk to people, make friends. and get experience. You know, even if you get an opportunity to talk to somebody who's, you know, already in the game space, pick their brains about what it's like and what's expected of them, because some people will be amazed that, you know, we work hard, play hard. When I say we work hard, we work hard.
Hard.
It is definitely a career choice that you have to have a passion for, because, you know, an example is tomorrow is Saturday, and I think we've got, you know, over 40 guys coming into the studio wanting to work, and they're coming up to a milestone, and we don't turn around and say, everybody has to be in. We just say, hey, we want to hit this milestone. If everybody's that passionate and everybody wants to achieve it, then what's the consensus? And, you know, I think most of the emails I've seen going back and forth is if you make us breakfast in the morning and you deliver some lunch in, then we're happy to come in. You know, so it's definitely a work hard, play hard environment.
Great. Well, I know there's a lot of people out there that are passionate and are hoping to get their break, so this advice will be good for them.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely.
Great. Well, thanks for stopping in, Carl.
No problem. Thank you all.
Bye-bye. That concludes our show, other than one final very important detail, which is information about our branded Tomb Raider Xbox 360 contest. So, by now you should have received the first two questions through Facebook and Twitter, and what you'll need to do is answer all three questions at tombraider.com/podcast. You'll also have to add in your full name and email address, and be sure to use the correct spelling. You have a lot of time to enter, so take your time if you need it. The contest is only open to those who are 18 plus, and it will run from September 15th, which is today, to October 13th. Also, because we will be custom skinning the Xbox after the winner is announced to ensure that the system is compatible with their territory, it'll take 6 to 7 weeks for the final delivery of the product. The winner will be announced through the blog within a week of the contest closure. And that's all the details, so now on to the final question. Question number 3. What was Lara Croft's original name before she was changed to have originated in the UK? It's an easy one for those of you who are big Tomb Raider aficionados. So, best of luck. Till next time.